Hey, welcome to Understanding Gradle. In this episode, we take a closer look at the task action concept in Gradle. In the video on implementing task, we have seen that a task action is the code that implements what a task is doing. So for example, the Java compile task implementation, which is part of Gradle core, calls the Java compiler to transform source code into bytecode in its task action. We also saw how to implement our own task with our own task actions by creating a class that extends Gradle's default task implementation and adding a method to it that we annotate with task action. To get an even better grasp of this concept, in this episode, we want to look at how you can dynamically modify task actions, in particular of tasks that are already registered. The things I show this time are for understanding and not necessarily for doing them in your build. But there can be situations where the things we learn today can be helpful to patch up things that are broken or do not fit completely to your use case. Let's look at an example. I have a simple Gradle build with one project that makes up a Java application containing one Java class and using Gradle's application plugin through our own application convention plugin. As part of our own plugin, I've already added a small task implementation. This task should do only one simple thing: printing out the version of our project to the command line. As we see, the class extends default task, as all task implementations do, and it has one input, which is of type property string. This is the version that the task should print, and then it has one method that is annotated with task action, which prints out the version. Here it is good to remember that there is a distinction between configuration code and execution code. The configuration code is executed during Gradle's configuration phase and builds up the model of your project in memory so that Gradle knows what it needs to do and what it does not need to do for a certain build invocation. Everything around the task actions, like the input or output properties, are part of this configuration code. Only the code inside the task action method is the execution code that does the actual work. It accesses the inputs and outputs to do some work if the task is part of the task graph and if it can't be skipped because it's up to date or it's taken from cache. Now, once we have this task implementation, we can use it in our build setup. So if we go to our convention plugin, we can register a new task there that uses our task implementation. Inside the configuration block for the task, we now write configuration phase code, which only modifies the values of input and output properties of the task, but does not touch the execution phase code. So the task action is not referred here in any way. It's something Gradle will pick up automatically if needed. Even for simple custom task implementations like this one, I prefer the setup because it makes a quite clean separation between configuration timecode and execution timecode. However, you could write tasks, especially simple tasks like this one, in a bit more compact way directly in the build script without creating a separate class for the task. Let's register another task and call it print version dynamic. This time we do not define a type for the task, which means the task will be of the general type default task. This general type does not define any task actions. That means it does not have methods annotated with task action. This type is useful for defining lifecycle tasks, which we looked at in the corresponding episode. But the default task type can also be used to define tasks with custom actions dynamically without additional classes. This is done by using the doFirst or doLast construct. Similar to defining a method and annotating it as a task action, this adds an action to this task. The methods are called doFirst and doLast because a task can have multiple actions. And if the task already has action defined, you can use this distinction to decide if your additional action should run before or after the existing actions. We'll get back to that in a bit. If you only have one action, which is the case here because we start with an empty task, you typically use the doLast method. Now we can add the action code inside this method. So we put our println statement here. Because we are in the build script here and have the whole project context, we could access the project version now here in the action code directly without declaring any inputs or something like that. this used to work, but what you do here is mixing the configuration time state and the execution time state. Because remember that the code here in the doLastAction block is execution time code compared to all the other code in the build script, which is configuration time code. If we activate the Gradle configuration cache, which you can do since Gradle 8.3 with the org Gradle configuration cache property in your Gradle properties file, the task implementation we just performed does not work. Gradle gives you an error when you attempt to run it. This is because the configuration cache requires a clean separation between this configuration time state, which is put into the cache, and the execution time state. We can fix this in our example by doing the same we did when we implemented the print version task as class. We can declare the version we want to print as an input. This can also be done dynamically. So instead of declaring a property and annotating it with input, as we have done in the class-based solution, we can use the general inputs properties that all tasks have to add a new input property here dynamically. We give this property some name, let's also call it version here, and then we can retrieve the value of the property in the task action. And now the task works exactly as it worked when we implemented it as class. So what we see here are two alternative approaches to implement a custom task in Gradle. The dynamic setup makes it a bit more compact. However, as I showed, it's easier to mix configuration time and execution time state here. It also can get hard to keep an overview if you need more inputs for a more complex task implementation. And then you see that this general inputs field here is untyped, so you have a map with string keys to arbitrary objects. So when you get things out of the map again in the task action, you need to know which types they are of and possibly cast them. When you implement your custom task as class, you can clearly define the inputs as properties with a dedicated type. We now saw how to use the API for adding task actions dynamically to define your own tasks, which is nothing new, but only an alternative to defining your custom tasks as classes. Where this dynamic modification of actions actually can give additional value is when you have tasks that are already registered, but which you need to modify for some reason. Let's take as an example the compile Java task, which is registered by the Java plugins. Once a task is registered, you can't remove it. It's also difficult and in certain cases impossible to remove certain task dependencies that have been set up already by the plugins you are using. If you combine several community plugins in your build, you can have situations where things are not completely compatible, or sometimes there might be bugs or unforeseen usages of a plugin in your build that leads to them almost working, but some little details don't fit. Here, the ability to add or modify task actions of tasks that have already been set up by a plugin can help you to patch things up. Let's first add an additional task action to the Java compile task. The original task, through its implementation in the Java compile class, has only one action, which is calling the Java compiler with all the inputs the task is configured with. Let's say we want to do something before and after the compilation. For demonstration purpose, let's just print out some statements. For this, we can now use the doFirst and the doLast method. Note that also in this custom code you add, you can access the inputs and outputs of the task, because that's the state that is available at execution time that the original task action also uses. When we run the build, we see how our additional task actions are executed as part of the compile Java task. When we run the build again and the task is up to date, also our custom actions are not executed. So they're really an extension of the actionable code of the existing task. What I just showed can already be useful if you want to investigate certain situations or problems over a longer time or on CI builds. You can use doFirst or doLast to do additional logging for tasks that are already registered. You could also patch up certain things. For example, if a task produces files, but the output properties of the task do not allow you to change the file names, you could rename the result files in the doLast action. Remember, for Gradle, all the actions make up the execution block. So Gradle will only look at the result of the task to calculate the output for up-to-date checks and so on in the end when all task actions have been executed. If this is not enough to patch things up, you can actually also modify the existing actions. This actions list each task has is mutable, so you can change it in the task configuration. For example, if a task has for some reason multiple actions already, you could change the order. Or you could remove existing actions. So here we could say, clear the actions list in the beginning of the compile Java task configuration, which will remove the original Java compile action, even though it has not been added dynamically, but is a method implemented in the Java compile class. If we do this and run our build, the compiled class of our application is missing, even though the compile Java task was executed, because now the original task action is no longer part of the build. Now, assuming for the sake of this example that the original compilation does not work for us, we can say we implement the compilation ourselves in the actions we add. For example, in our doLast action, we can call the Java C command with the input files and the output directory configured for this task. And now our build works again, and we were able to do that without rewiring any task setup or dependencies. So we keep the existing task structure, but do adjustment to the actual action of a task. Of course, in this case, this is not a complete implementation. The task has much more inputs, for example, that are passed as parameters to the Java compiler. For a bit simpler tasks, maybe from community plugins that do not completely fit your current setup, this can be a last resort to get around blockers. Of course, in these cases, it might be good to report back to the authors of the plugin to make things more configurable that you don't need to resort to this way of modifying existing task implementations. In this video, we learned that task inputs, outputs, and actions can be dynamically modified. This is good to know if you need to patch things where one of the plugins you are using does not completely fit your use case. It can also be used to define small custom tasks in a more compact way. It also showed us again the difference between Gradle configuration timecode and execution timecode. That is important to keep this in mind, especially when you set up custom tasks. And we saw that the configuration cache feature will fail the build if you mix up configuration and execution time state. As usual, you find a link to the example in Kotlin and Groovy DSL in the description of the video. The description also gives links to further readings and other related videos. If you enjoy this content, please consider subscribing to this channel. See you next time.